Hello everybody, they call me Muse, and this is the first bit of Aces and Adventures. It's a card-based strategy game where you use decks of regular cards and decks of special abilities to try and defeat a bunch of enemies. Similar sort of thing to Solitarica, but with poker hands instead of solitaire runs. Now, this isn't technically the first bit because I've played the game for about 20 hours over the last week, but I did want to show it off. And this will be the first time I've played as this particular character, so technically it's the first bits. And then I'll show you a run with a character I'm more familiar with as well, so you can get a good feel for what the game's all about. Now, when you normally begin, you'll just have Spring available. Spring, Summer, Fall and Winter are 4 difficulty levels. There's a 5th one I haven't unlocked yet. And then there's a few different game modes which we'll look at in a bit. But normally you just start with Spring and you start with a Seedling deck. Now, there's 5 characters that you can unlock. You unlock them all within about an hour of gameplay, I'd say. The Warrior, the Rogue, who is my bestie, the Mage, who we're playing as today, the Hunter, and the Enchantress. So, this will be my first ever time of playing as the Mage. They start with 0 attack, 0 defense, and 6 health, so they're pretty fragile. Let's see what they're capable of. We've only got 1 deck at the moment, which is our starter deck, which remains untouched. And let's jump in.
The first breath of fall fills your lungs, crisp in the morning rays of an aging summer sun. Before you lies the space that mountains made, like open hands for life to grow beneath low clouds.
So this default adventure mode, it delivers the story to you on a series of cards, as we can see here, and you can click through the cards and then get into the actual action.
A trail plunges into the veil ahead. Behind you, there is nothing. No memory of yourself or how you came to this place. Just the gentle pull of a sloped path and the courage to draw the next card from the deck of fate.
Basically, once you've seen these once, you've seen them. And that's that. So you'll generally click through these pretty quickly, the majority of the time.
A pilgrim bearing a stone walks along a riverbank. Startled by your sudden appearance, the stone is raised in defense.
And now we're going to get a scrap with a lad.
Who are you?
Prepare yourself.
So here we are. We've got 6 health. He's got 4. He's got 1 offense and 2 defense. You don't need to worry too much about what the stats are. Basically, higher numbers are better for you. And we've got a deck of cards. It's all fairly standard. And we've got a deck of abilities, which we will come across soon enough. I've no idea what the mage plays like, so we'll have to see how this plays out. So we've got a fireball. We can deal 3 damage to all enemies if we play 2 heart cards. And we've got an ice bolt. Deals 1 damage to an enemy, and we can top deck and tap them if we win. So let's play that. 1 damage. We pulled a higher card off the top of our deck than he did, and so we froze in the bugger. Now, we could throw a fireball probably and just beat him at this point, or we could hang on to the fireball for our next fight. So our normal attacks, they're based on poker hands, so with these 4 cards, the best we've got is high card king. And because that is a hand that uses 1 card, it will deal 1 damage. By clicking on the pilgrim, we can automatically select our attack.
My power is ancient.
We can manually select attack cards if we want, but most of the time, the best attack selected for you will do the job. Now, this is a pair of 5s, and that will do 2 damage because it's 2 cards. He normally would have attacked back, but because we tapped him with the ice bolt, he didn't do so. So we're just going to get the kill.
Wait!
Forgive my haste, stranger.
There we go. We're now going to make amends with 2 M's.
Bear arms and walk on 2 feet, pulled from their embrace of Mother Earth by the lure of power. Here, take this healing draught to restore the vigor our misunderstanding cost you.
Well, we didn't lose any vigor because we're ace, but we'll have a drink anyway.
I'm in balance again.
You've forgotten yourself? This shady path leads to a witch first in brews known to stir the mind. But I must follow the river. Swift journey, traveler. The seasons are changing. Warmth won't be free for long.
So I guess we're going to find the witch then.
I've learned a new spell.
And we've learned an ability. So let's have a look. Instead of attacking, we can draw a card. So it feels like the mage's thing is going to be attacking with his abilities more than his regular attacks.
The sun mottles the forest floor in leaves of light. A strange fire weaves its way through the woods.
And now we find ourselves fighting
the stars are in alignment.
A fox with a lantern attached. Very well. So we've got fire, which just deals 2 damage to an enemy. That's pretty cool. And we've got the conjured cloak, which requires a club, and gains us a shield and draws us a card. So let us throw that. Now, if we draw the shield, then they're removed at the start of our turn. So it'll stick around long enough for the fox's attack. And now we find ourselves with 2 sevens, which is a pair. So let's fire away. And you can see he defended with a bunch of cards at the top, but you didn't have anything better than a pair of sevens.
Seeing a fox go on 2 legs, much less wielding a spear by lantern light. Of course, you don't remember much at all. Fortunately, the struggle has returned some of the memory to your limbs.
Memory? That's going to level us up, I believe.
Magic when found.
There we go. So, yeah, each character has 3 level 1 traits, 3 level 2 traits, and 3 level 3 traits. Because we're level 0 on the mage, we've only got 1 to choose from. We don't have that one until we get to level 3, and we don't get the final level 1 trait until we get to level 15. So, we will take this one, 1 max hand size and 1 max ability size. Generally, in my experience, that's pretty good. I'm happy with that.
Smell. Guides you through the thickening thicket to a wall of thorns. There, you spy a hut, sinking in the mist.
A hut? For a witch, maybe?
A cauldron lid clatters in the contest against its contents, losing upon your arrival to a viscous hand.
Viscous. The narrator's pretty good.
I have seen your end.
Even if you don't generally listen to what she's saying after the first time you hear it all. So we've got card trick. We can change one of our cards so that its suit can be anything. Good if we're going for flushes. But for now, I think we'll just use our fireball that we've been hanging on to. Deal 3 damage to everyone and win the fight in a turn.
Oh, my hero. Long roots on you. And nigh a trace of that foul infernal magic that caused my cauldron to bubble over so willfully. Now, how to thank you for saving me from my renegade soup?
Saving me from my renegade soup. It's not often you'll hear the phrase renegade soup. But we have a choice.
Well, where's the last place you remember seeing it? This misty potion is good for the memory, or perhaps you prefer a health tonic, a banquet in every bottle.
And so the choice is between restoring some health, which we don't need.
The path from potential to power is littered by many bottles.
Or taking the potion of memory and getting a second level up.
Yes.
Now we'll do 1 damage with all of our abilities. Very nice.
A thaumaturge, an alchemist, a bit of a cook. I am these things. But an oracle is what you require. Seek out the crook in the mountains where the sun makes its bed. There you will find a circle of stones and a cave beyond it.
Very well. Off we go then.
Should you survive, you will come to a desert of black sand. Where a grand pillar cut by giant hands reaches into the blue vault. The Oracle's temple sits like a jewel atop this scepter.
So Titan's Ladder could be our destination down the line.
But be warned, infernal magic leaks from this cave like an open wound. Ah. I will have to find a new place to collect the slime for my soup.
Maybe just don't have slime in your soup. What's wrong with chicken?
A white tree emerges from the mist like a lonely ghost. Its bare branches bring a strange sorrow to the rim of your eyes. Just then, two figures leap from the bushes and scare away the spectre of a memory.
I guess we best beat them up then.
I wield a menagerie of
elephants. So, we've got an enemy with an ability. Guard. We have to attack this guy before we can get to the lantern fox. So, we've got a pair of aces, so we could use those. And then we'd still have a club left over for our cloak to shield it. If we didn't, though, then we could have wild suited something into a different colour. We could take this two of hearts and make it wild and then turn it into a two of clubs. But we don't need to do that. We will just fire this off. He's got a pair of queens, which is pretty strong, but it's not enough.
I make my own refuge.
And then there we go. Now, there's nothing else we can really do. We could wild suit a card, but we've got no reason to right now. So let's just let them play out their turn. And so, he's attacking with four different cards, because his attack's four, our defense is zero. So he gets four cards to attack with. Basically, it's offense and defense when you get them. They don't increase your damage or the damage you take. What they do is they increase your chances of attacking successfully or defending successfully. But we've got aces to spare. He's attacking with one card, so we can only defend with one. So ace versus ace means we'll survive without taking damage. Now the lantern fox is attacked with a queen. We've got another ace though. And because our ace is higher than the queen, not only will we successfully defend, we'll counterattack for a point of damage.
Prepare yourself.
Some of the characters might be barely defensive oriented, some of them might be fairly offensively oriented, some of them in middle ground. But now it's our turn again, and we've got a pair, so that's probably worth launching off with. He's got five cards to defend with, because 5 minus 0 is 5, but it wasn't enough. Now he can turn an ace into a wild card till end of turn, if we wish. But for now, we'll let the lantern fox attack again. Pair of twos. We've got a pair of eights. That's better. So let's use that.
I wield the menagerie.
And now we've got a pair of jacks so we can finish off the fox. Oh, but he's countered with a pair of kings, which is enough to deal 2 damage to us. Because again, he defended with 2 cards. Therefore, he dealt 2 damage. Curses. Now he's attacking with a pair of fives. What can we do about that? We haven't got an ace to turn into a wild card. Changing a suit won't help us, so I think we're just taking damage here. And again, it's 2 damage that we're taking, so we'll put up our crappiest cards. Now, we could attack with a king. If he draws an ace, he'll hit us. If he draws a king, it's level. If he draws anything else, we're fine. But he's got 4 cards to choose from. So maybe we're just better off using Arcane Volley. Let's try it. Let's try the king. And of course he draws an ace. Dagnabbit. So we've taken a lot of damage in this fight. But we can finish him off with the Arcane Volley.
A strange man leans against a sack of goods on the side of the road. A single eye gleams at you from the shade of a wide-brimmed hat.
I've little care for the makings of man. Second-hand goods and all. But the leaves you bear, those I shall trade for something more useful to you.
And so we come across the merchant, who you'll see in every adventure. Now, we could gain armor, which would give us a permanent 1 defense, which would basically reduce the number of cards that our attackers have got by 1 compared to what they would otherwise have. Offense would reduce the number of cards they have when defending by 1. Or we could take a steel skin potion, which heals us and grants a shield. And it costs us abilities. So let's take the steel skin potion in exchange for card trick. Do we turn in the other two to get some extra offense? I don't think so, because the mage is an ability-based class. So I don't think we need the extra offense. Let's just move on with our lives.
You track a timid path to a bend in the river. arriving as the pilgrim hurls his rock at a wall on the far bank. It chips and tumbles into the water.
Just a single stone.
You hear him sigh.
That's all my life was.
Friend Pilgrim.
This wall represents the unknown, or so my ancestors say. I've thrown the stone I brought from the mouth of the river, and so I join my strength to the arm of my descendant who will, someday, break this wall.
Okay, that's what his pilgrimage was all about.
Was the witch able to conjure your past?
He asks.
My pilgrimage is over, but it sounds as if yours has just begun. This is the fastest path up the mountain, but there is smoke that smells of meat, and I know not its source.
And now we have a choice ahead of us again.
The other road curls by the den of a great bear who, legend claims, taught the other animals to stand. I doubt any path will be simple, but whichever you walk, I hope it gets you to where you need to go.
Take the most direct.
So yeah, we'll find these various paths in the various adventures. So we could go directly up the mountain through the smoke, or we could avoid the smoke and go around, and then we'll probably have to fight a bear. So let's take the smoke.
You come upon a camp of lively forms frolicking around a tall flame. Fluidly, their dance flows into advance. You scarcely have time to raise your defense.
And now we're getting attacked by.
My power is ancient.
A shamphibian. A shaman amphibian. And a saber claw, which does look pretty deadly, all told. So maybe we'll start by drinking our potion, just to get back a bit of health, because we kind of need it. No, it would be nice if we had an extra heart. So we could have used card trick, actually, so we could get off our fireball. Maybe we will draw a card instead of attacking.
Angels, lend me your power.
Ah, it draws us an ability instead of attacking. Very well. I thought it was going to draw us a numerical card, because I was hoping for another heart. But let's launch off our arcane volley. Two and two. I'm glad they both hit the healer, because otherwise he would have restored some health to them both during their turn. But as it is, we've got a shield up. Saberclaw is going to do what? Launch two tens at us. We can counter with two tens. Take no damage.
The stars are in alignment.
Seal of Set. So we can deal 2 damage from an enemy and negate their traits till end of round. So if this guy had a trait like guard or healer, then we could get around it by negating it. But for now, we'll just throw that at him. And this is actually a debuff, so it sits on the enemy, as well as dealing 2 damage to them. But it actually dealt 3 because of our trait, which gives us extra ability damage. Now we could throw a fireball, or we could save those till our next combat, and we could try attacking with our king. Or we could draw an ability. Yeah, it actually says draw an ability rather than draw a card, so I should have paid attention to that before I used it last.
The sand holds many secrets.
Let us draw that ability and see what we get, and it's an ice bolt. We like those. It'll deal 2 damage because of our level 2 trait, and it would have sapped him anyway. So we've got a choice now. You'll see this choice quite a lot, which is, do you level up again, or do you heal your health? And we're going to go with level up, get our third and final trait, and that reduces the cost of all of our ability. Oh my god, that's great. Our fireballs now cost 1 heart instead of 2.
Lighting an orange beacon before giving into night. You follow the last rays to ruins high on the ridge. Stones stand like teeth before a yawning cavern. A black robe hovers ominously over a central altar.
So we find a black robe, probably with a villain inside of it. And there we go, the cloaked figure. Deadly Darks, so he deals +1 attack damage with each of his black cards. Now, we have got a couple of fireballs that we could throw. Seems like a good idea, if you ask me, because they'll each deal 4 damage. Definitely a good start. Let's draw an ability instead of attacking. Because we could have attacked with a 10, but that's not a great attack, is it, really? It's not going to deal a lot of damage. So we've got a couple of wild suits that we can play at some point. And wild mana, but we don't have any aces. Now, he's launching a king at us. There's not a great deal we can do about that. So we'll take a hit.
The stars are in alignment.
Mage armor. It's a buff, so this will stick around on us. Gain two shields when it's replaced by a different ability.
Ancient,
we'll definitely put that
on. Power.
So now, he's got six offense. So he would normally attack us with six cards. Now that we've put the buff on, we've got one defense. So he's now only going to attack us with five cards. Now, do we attack with our pair of tens? It's a pretty strong attack. Or do we draw an ability? Let's draw an ability. It's the mage thing to do. And now we'll actually deal 4 damage by playing an Arcane Volley, which used to cost diamond, but now is free because of our 3rd level trait. So, 2 damage. 2 more damage. Down he goes.
The luster fades from the golden thread, and the cloth falls dead in the wind.
There we go, we've been threatened by a piece of cloth.
The mouth of the cave heaves a baleful breath. A faint glow within grows more insistent as your eyes begin to accept the darkness.
And there we go, adventure one completed. We have finished spring, we gained some extra mana, which is XP basically, for surviving after going down to 1 HP. We completed it for the first time with the mage, so that's extra mana still. And because we spent 8 minutes playing our cards and thinking about it, we got an A rank. That's one thing I'm not hugely fond of in this game, is the fact that you're based on time as to whether or not you get the most from your XP and everything. I'd rather have just time to think about things rather than needing to rush to try and get S ranks. But the times for S ranks do seem to be fairly generous, and once you know your deck well, there is less thinking to be done, so it's not a major issue. Now let's get some mana. We've gained a level up and some new cards, which is shared across our various characters. I've turned on faster animations there in the option menu, which is something you definitely want to do because, there we go, quick mana vial animations. Turn it on early, you'll save a lot of time. Similarly, turn off sync narrative text with voiceover, and then you can click through the cards nice and quick. I turned on Luck of the Poor so that all of my face cards are now cats rather than queens and kings. Because why not? Why wouldn't you? And so that's your basic adventure. You've got a series of them, and you go through them all in spring and summer and fall and winter, and then the 5th difficulty, which I haven't yet unlocked, which is Invernal. And then level ups happen on this table here on the right. So we could say put our mage in the pot, because it's curious, you don't need to level up characters that you've just played as. So I've nearly exclusively been playing as my rogue, which is at the max level of 30. And by doing so, I've leveled up the hunter and the enchantress to 30. And they've both been rebirthed, so they're now working their way up again. So when you level them up to 30 a second time, you then get the ability to use any of your traits, rather than having them separate as level 1, level 2, level 3 traits. And then you can level them up a third time as well, which is mostly for cheeves. We've put the mage in now. Bonk. So now we can redraw one of our cards at the beginning of our adventure. And we're working our way towards the cheeve. We're leveling him up. We've got a new level 1 trait now. Gain an additional attack. And gain 2 offense and 2 attack damage with diamonds. So if we wanted to go for a more attacking build, then we could use that rather than using our abilities. We can draw an ability when we rest now. Now we've got a Joker in the deck as well. So you can see that we're making life easier for ourselves. So this is a level 2 trait. 1 defense, 2 max health, 1 defense per heart in hand, heart, steel, extra defense damage. So again, that's for a more attacking mage kind of build. And now we've got the trump card, which is an ability that you can just use at any time, basically, but you can only use it once per adventure. So we can make an ability free in a pinch. You can now redraw an additional card at the start. A level 3 trait, plus 1 offense, and wild range, plus 1 for your red card. So, say, the 8 hearts could also be a 7 of hearts or a 9 of hearts. Allows you to make pairs and straights and whatnot a lot easier. Bit more health. An extra ability in your starting hand. Instead of attacking, you can overdraw an ability and draw a card. So, overdrawing means you can draw one more than you should be allowed to have. And then you have to discard one to get back down to your right number. But there we go, we've got our mage up to level 13 all of a sudden. Which is nice. But now let's have a look at one of the higher difficulties, shall we? Let's play that same adventure again, except we'll play it in winter and we'll play it on the rogue, which is my favourite class.
Mother, what?
So we've got my Nightfall deck on the go. And we'll see how things change. So firstly, because I'm maxed out, I can mulligan at the start. So I'm going to get rid of all of those because they're not face guards. And we start with the level 1 trait. So we're going to take Shadow Emissary. So our attacks and defenses with clubs can tap the target. Because the point of this deck is going to be tap the target as much as possible. Stop them from attacking. Now these story cards are going to be the same. They're always the same. So you just click through them. But now we've got a level 3 Pilgrim. So he's got First Strike. So he's actually moved ahead of us. He's also got Safe Attack. So even if we successfully defend, it won't hurt him. And he's got Volatile Combat, so he can deal double damage, or no damage. But we'll successfully defend there, because he had a pair of nines, we had a pair of jacks. And now it's our turn. Now, he's tapped because he's attacked, so we could use Shotei Palm to just deal 3 damage to him straight off. We haven't got amazing cards here. Our highest is just a jack, which is not great. We've got a few different abilities. We may as well use Backstab. We've got it here. So I didn't even need to use Shotei, because if I'm using Backstab, I'm dealing a total of 10 damage to him anyway, because he starts before us.
Watch your back.
So there we go.
Wait. Forgive my haste.
Victory is ours.
You forgot.
And we got the health potion from him, as before. And now the Lantern Fox. So it attacks twice per turn with double attack. Deals extra damage with spades. And again, it's got Safe Attack, so defending against it doesn't do anything, really. Doesn't deal damage to it. But our 10s beat his 5s. And because we played a club, we've tapped him, so he's not going to attack next turn. Now, the hero ability that the rogue starts with it is Dual Wield. So it lets you have an extra attack. It's telling us to use the 3 to play it, because it's our lowest card. But it's also part of a pair. So let's instead click the 9, and then we can play Dual Wield, and it will use the 9 instead. And now we can use our pairs to attack again. So they deal 2 damage because they're a pair, and they deal 1 extra damage because of Dual Wield. So that was 3 more damage. So that's a good first turn.
Time to strike.
Now our new turn, we draw 5 cards, and we draw 1 ability. Now Nightfall turns all our red cards into black cards if we need them to. So it's pretty amazing. We're going to put that buff on straight away because that's one of the keys to the deck. And then we're going to attack with a pair of aces because we've got a Joker. And we got the attack off successfully. Now we could cast Dual Wield because it costs a card, but then we wouldn't have any cards left to attack with. So we could just leave our turn there. We can't afford to do anything else, basically. And if this was a lower card, I would use Dual Wield just to get rid of it. But because it's a face card, we'll hold on to it. Now he's got Ace Attack. We've got no defense, so 8 cards to choose from. He's playing a pair of sixes. There's very little we could do except play our trump card. So I think we'll just let that go. We'll take the 2 damage. And now for his second attack, pair of tens. Again, there's not a lot we can do, so let's take two more damage.
You are not fit it's to fight my shadow.
And now, single king is our best attack. But it gets the job done. And now we can dual wield there and play a single jack, hopefully for the win. He doesn't have a lot of defense. He's got three defense. Sadly, that was enough to successfully defend there. But we can play a Rashi, and that will finish him off. Two damage to all enemies. I'd rather save it for a group fight, but I'd also rather not take any more damage. Thank you very much.
No technique is forbidden.
So we've leveled up again, which gave us one health back. And we're going to take Thief, so we'll draw an ability after every successful attack. Standard attack. Now, we probably should have saved Arashi, to be honest. Because these lads have got superior sapping, so they will cause us to discard abilities if they successfully attack. They've got Siphon, so they can suck damage from us with attacks. And they've got Armor Penetration, which ignores our defense. Now, what can we do? We've got three hearts, but we don't have any diamonds. I'm going to see if we can draw a diamond by just using the move card. I'm not going to move behind them because I haven't got a backstab right now. But yeah, we got a diamond. Good. So I'm now going to play Mephitic Grenade to tap them all so that they won't attack in this turn. Now we'll attack with a pair of fives. We could play Garrosh at this point, which removes all of his abilities. But I'm thinking we're going to kill him fairly quickly. Do we play Garrosh anyway? I don't think we need to. Especially because we've got Showtai Palm. So let's deal some extra damage to that one. And that one's almost down. We'll keep hold of the Queen. We won't play Dual Wield.
You are not fit to fight my
and there we go. We've got another Arashi, which I was hoping for. Because that's going to be enough damage to kill that bad boy off. Now, as for this one, pair of queens, including a club, will tap it if they're successful, which they are. And again, we could Garrosh it, but we should be able to take that one down next turn. And then I will use Dual Wield. We can't attack because it's our last card, but it will get rid of the 8, which means we'll hopefully draw something better than an 8. Now, pair of aces coming in. But we can play Smoke Bomb and prevent that attack. And then we could play all five here because of our Nightfall ability, all of our reds can become black. So if we play all five, they all become clubs. Should have probably launched that at the other Vile Cauldron just because there's no overkill then. But it's fine. And then that's pretty much our turn. So let's see what we get. Pair of aces is nice. Let's play the Ace of Hearts. I want to keep the Ace of Clubs for his turn, because then we can tap him by successfully attacking with it. We're not going to use our Garrosh. We'll play Dual Wield. And even though it's only a 9, we could attack with it, because the Dual Wield attack is a safe attack, so we won't be taking damage if we lose. But we've also got Speed of Shadow, so let's launch that, and that will give us better cards, hopefully. Gives us a pair of sixes with our Joker, and we get the kill. So we could potentially use the Healing Drought here, because we are only on 6 health. But I would rather get my level ups as soon as possible. So now, Unrelenting Darkness. We get 2 plus offense per black card in our attack, so our attacks are more likely to be successful with black cards. Nightfall is giving us more black cards, so it all works out well. And we redraw cards that we used in an attack containing black cards. So basically, if we attack with black cards, we get them replenished. So, now I've got Superior Guard on this one. So it must be attacked and targeted for hostile abilities before enemies without Superior Guard. They also take less attack damage because they've got defensive and they've got shielded. So they are very strong at attacking, and that bugger behind is going to be difficult to get to. But we can start by launching a flush in spades. And because they're all black cards, they're all going to get replaced. And maybe we'll also garrot this guy. So there we go, all his abilities have now buggered off, which is great. And now at this stage, although even if he still has superior guard, we could still attack both with an any card ability. So let's manually change that to a four of clubs. And because it's got a club in it, it's going to deal one damage to each of them, and it's going to tap them both because of our shadow emissary. I think I'll use Shotai as well, because I want to reduce their numbers as much as possible. And then we'll dual wield, and we'll attack with an ace. Dang. Still had a good defense, so he had five cards to choose from, so that didn't get the job done. Which is a shame. Now this turn, we'll play through the crowd, and that will tap them both again. It'll also deal two damage, which isn't the main point of it, but as it happens, it was enough to get the kill there. Now we'll attack with an ace, which gets blocked, but then we'll dual wield, and we'll attack with a pair for 3 damage. And because this guy has been hit with clubs, he's tapped, so he's not going to attack. And now we can play a flush for 5 damage. Excellent.
A strange man leads.
And now we find the merchant again, and this time we've got 6 abilities in our hand.
I
so
pay my debts.
Let us get rid of some of them, shall we? Get some more this offense, one. Get some more defense as well. We'll keep hold of Garrot +1 because it's amazing.
You track a tip.
And then we've got the old pilgrim again, we've got the wall, which is actually breaking down a bit more. I just realized that. The other road take the most direct. We're going to go the other way this time.
Lulled by the gently winding road, the pilgrim's warning slips your mind until a bend brings you face to face with a lumbering figure standing tall in the path.
It's the one who stands.
Surrender. And
it's an iron bear. But yeah, the broken wall in the picture there, I just noticed it's looking a lot more cracked now that we've gone through a bunch of pilgrimages. And a bunch of stones have been thrown at it. But yes, it's Iron Bear +3. He's got double attack. He's got defensive. He's got regeneration. It's going to be a pain in the butt to deal with. So let's throw some queens at him. And that will allow us to get off a Garrot. The ability to remove an opponent's traits. It's just amazing. It just keeps you going, basically. Now, we could also go through the crowd and tap him. That's probably wise, because our next attack isn't going to be with a club. So this is the only way we've got to tap him. And this rogue build is all about tapping the enemy wherever possible.
Talon's ready.
Now, we've got a king. But at this stage, I think, we need to ensure that we're tapping him again. And then we just need to get rid of some of our crapper cards. So yeah, bit of a wash that turn. Nothing exciting going on. But we kept him tapped, and that's the main thing. Now, just a jack to attack. That's not fantastic. Because he's got good defense. So yeah, he got through there, and he dealt a damage to us.
My daggers will sing.
And that 8 was never going to connect. So we failed to tap him this time, so we're going to actually have to deal with his attack. But luckily we drew a joker, so let's play a pair of 5s and deal a bit of damage. Now, through the crowd isn't useful right now, because we're already on the right-hand side. So, pair of 7s, bit of damage, and 1 was a club, so that's great. We can use Speed of Shadows to filter out the 3 and 5 for hopefully better cards, and it will overdraw us abilities. So now we've drawn 7, even though our max is 6, which means we can drop one. We've already got Nightfall on us. The second one's sort of a backup, just to make sure that you get it as quickly as possible in the deck. So we'll drop that. Now we use a 7 to play dual wield so that we can use a pair of 6s to deal the fatal blow. Now, do we level up again? We can't because we're already actually at the max level.
No.
So I guess we're taking one defense and gaining one shield at the start of our turn, which is very nice.
In a stone cradle, lighting an
and then we reach the circle of stones as before. But our cloaked figure now is +3. So they have dark mastery. They deal extra attack damage and they take less attack damage from black cards. That's basically all we do is hit with black cards, so that's horrible. And entities with nullified dark can't be hit by black abilities either. And he's also got a second phase and double attack. So this is generally horrible. And we find ourselves without any Garrots in our deck. Let's see. So yeah, Through the Crowd just gets negated, as you can see, because of his ability. But if we play... let's just play that. We just want to use up some of our abilities at this stage to free up room in our hand for more abilities. Still haven't got a Garrot, that's horrible. But we've got an ace there. So we can play the Ace of Diamonds to not deal any damage as it happens. We may as well play our clubs out, just because we can. So yeah, this isn't going well. Let's play a contract just to get it out of our hand. So we heal 3 when we kill this guy. Although this is the end of the adventure, so it's not terribly useful. And he nullified it anyway, so that's fine. Now, is he going to nullify Smoke Bomb?
Vanish.
Yeah, he does. Oh no, he doesn't. Smoke Bomb doesn't get nullified because it doesn't target him directly. So let's play another one. And we've prevented any damage from it. Now, let us... play a Jack of Clubs there. Yep, make that a Jack. So that's a pair. So that will deal 1 damage to him. And hopefully it'll tap him as well. Yeah, so he can still be tapped. Good. And there's Garrot. Thank you. That's what we need. So we'll play a Dual Wield.
I'm not done yet.
We can deal 1 damage with the Ace of Clubs, hopefully. Fantastic. And then we can... Garrot +1 though requires a spade, which means it will be nullified. So it's not actually helpful. So we may as well get rid of it just because we don't need it. And then we don't need to play move just yet. We've got him tapped next turn, so let's see. We need to draw a regular Garrot or we're buggered. King of Clubs though. Still gets the tap off, even though it does no damage. That's fine. And then let's play 4 cards and move just to, again, just to draw through our deck and hopefully get some higher value cards. And let's play another contract just because it gets it out of the way so we can draw more abilities.
I will end this.
Right. 3 of a kind, that's nice. We like 3 of a kind. Where are all our Garrots? I'm very sad. We haven't got enough red cards to play Mephistic. So let's play another Nightfall, just to get rid of the old one, to free up some space. May as well Dual Wheel to get rid of that 10 of clubs. Didn't expect it to do anything, and it hasn't. So now he's going to get some more attacks off. But we're going to successfully defend against his 4s with our kings. And then he's going to play 2 jacks, and we're going to successfully defend with our jacks.
Surrender, and this will be painless.
So that could have gone worse, definitely. There's no point playing a flush here with spades. So let us instead Well, if we play the flush, then we draw new cards. We might get some better cards. Yeah, that's better, I feel. Because then we could dual wield. We could play the queens, I think. And get the tap. And one damage, that's fine. And then that'll allow us to play Shotai. To get three more damage, which is great. And then we may as well just play the through the crowds, just to get rid of them. Again, to free up space. You can see how much more complicated this is on Winter difficulty than it ever was on the previous one. So three aces, one of which is a club, gets a tap. And we've got two more Shotais. Can't believe we haven't found a Garrot yet. This is the worst. But we got the tap off, so let's again filter out some of our low value cards. I suppose I could have played the 3 instead of the 9 there, but it's fine. Now, Ace of Spades is going to deal nothing. So let's Mephitic just to make sure he's tapped. Ace of Spades at least will allow us to draw another card, which is a Ten of Hearts. Slim chance, but the Ten of Hearts might connect. Nope, he drew an ace.
You are not fit to fight my shadow.
And still, no Garrot. Awful cards as well. High card 7. That's terrible. High card Jack. That's mildly better. But it's not a great deal better. Is it even worth trying to play it? Let's just clear out some cards that we can't use. We might have to take some damage here, but we've still got our trump card. So he's playing a king. So yeah, let's play our trump card now. So we cancel an attack. We tap him so he won't get any other attacks. And our next turn deals double damage. Which sounds just grand. Although the cards we've got to play are awful. So let's play our 10. He's going to probably defend this. And then let's dual wield. And let's just play our 9 of clubs. Which again he defends. Let's get rid of our Arashi. Now he's launching a queen at us. Let's block it with our own queen. That's all we need to worry about there. And he's launching a king. Let's block it with an ace of hearts so we can deal one damage.
Alan's ready.
There it is. Garrot has finally showed up. So let's launch a pair of eights. That'll deal one damage. And now because Garrot doesn't cost anything, the regular version, it actually connects. Dark Mastery is gone. Nullify Dark is gone. Double attack is gone. This guy is now in trouble. Let's play a move card now. Get behind him. Launch a backstab for 5 damage. Suddenly he's not looking so tough. Bit of Shotai Palm there. Because why not? We've got a flush. Huge damage once again. And we could now dual wield and launch a pair of queens for a bit more damage. And then we could even play Arashi plus 1 for 2 more damage. And just like that, the second phase is gone and he's bested. So there we go. We got a bit of mana for 3 of a kind for plus 10 damage in a turn for flushes. And it was A rank. Pleased with that. That's some more levels unlocked. And some new cards. Anything exciting? Nothing that I'm looking for particularly. But there we go, that shows how winter is wildly more difficult than spring. Now before we go, we'll just touch on the other modes briefly. So there's a gauntlet mode where You start with a deck of your choice, I think, and work your way through a series of challenges. And then there's daily versions of War of the Branches and Infernal Spiral. So War of the Branches, again, you pick your own deck. It's got multiple difficulty levels. We've completed three of them so far. Haven't finished Winter yet.
What is the mark?
And what this mode looks like, you don't have to click through a whole bunch of story in this mode. I'll tell you that much.
I feel
sharp. We'll pick our opening. And then here we go. Look at this. Look at all of this. It's amazing. This is more of a sort of Slay the Spire, Monster Drain sort of mode where you can pick things as you go. So you can work your way through. You can pick big bonuses like merchants or level ups at various points and rests. Ability shrines will let you make your abilities cheaper or copy them or remove them from your deck. You've got card shrines which allow you to remove cards from your deck or make them wild cards. You've got various boss fights along the way. A rock there, Lilith and some infernal spawns there, and then the big final boss Invernus at the end. So yeah, it's a pretty cool mode. All sold. Now, can we get back to the main screen? We can just end the adventure there. Because Infernal Spiral, this is more kind of like the traditional Slay the Spire type thing, in that you start with the same starter deck every time, and you have to adjust it as you go.
I am the snake.
So the rogue deck I would start with wouldn't be the special one that I just made. This would be a standard sort of rogue deck, with all the regular everyday rogue abilities. And this mode, yeah, look at it. Look how you spiral around the edge and you spiral into the middle. This one takes about 20-30 minutes to play, I'd say. It's meaty. It's good. I think that between War of the Branches and Infernal Spiral, there's a hell of a lot of gameplay here. And then, yeah, you've got the daily versions of those where you've got special abilities. So, like, if you've got a character that plays with hearts a lot, then the Buy Hearts mode of Infernal Spiral could be pretty fun. If you've got War of the Branches, if you've got a deck that doesn't use sixes through kings, what? That seems like a crazy multiplier. But yeah, between the five different classes and the various game modes, there's a hell of a lot going on here, and I thoroughly recommend Aces and Adventures. So hopefully you've enjoyed watching. Hopefully you'll think about giving this a try at some point. And I'll see you soon. Thanks for watching, friends.